concept of what we're trying to do is we're trying to use inflatables to bring payload to a destination that has an atmosphere. And inflatables have advantages in that they're lightweight, they're compact, and we can make them very large to slow down payloads as we enter an atmosphere. We have about 75 people working on this project for us across the agency, in a combination of contractors and civil servants, and actually that's full-time equivalent, so it's more like a couple hundred people are touching this technology in some form or another. Amanda, you want to tell us a little bit about why?
Sure. So, you know, we've been exploring space, right? We want to better understand our Earth system, and we want to understand our solar system, where it originated, and, you know, what it's looking like. So we're going and exploring other planets and other locations. So, did you know that we don't currently have the capability to land something the size of a big car or a truck on a location such as Mars? Do you know that? I don't know if some people, you know, quite really, we don't have the ability, or we have not yet done that. So you heard of the Mars Science Laboratory getting ready to launch at the end of this year. Very exciting, right? We're looking forward to that and wish them the best of luck. So that is a rigid heat shield. That's the same method we've been using ever since we've been exploring Mars, for example. What makes this unique and different is that it's a deployable. So the rigid heat shields are constrained by our launch vehicles. We have to get it off of the Earth's surface, right? So it has to fit within the fairing and the structure there, which therefore limits how big our payload can be and how much it can weigh. So the advantage of these is that they can package up in a smaller place. So this is actually in the deployed configuration, but it can package up smaller. And then before we enter our destination with an atmosphere, we deploy it. By doing that, we get a very large surface area. And since we have that large surface area, the heating at any one location is lower as relative to a smaller rigid feature. So really what this allows us to do is land more mass, but also potentially at a higher elevation too. So did you know that right now, when we go explore Mars, for example, we land at below sea level? I don't know if people realize that. I think MSL is getting ready to land in the bottom of a crater. So that would be like somebody coming here to explore Earth and landing in the ocean, and not seeing the mountains or the deserts or the other things that we hear after on Earth. So there's a lot of science there. Scientists want to go and explore, you know, further their search for water, et cetera. So this is one of the methods we're actually using the atmosphere to slow down. But at right hand to the ground is the Earth's atmosphere. It's very thick. And the density on Mars is thinner. It would be like looking between my two fingers here. So it's a lot thinner. So you can't ignore it because there is an atmosphere there. But it's not very thick, so it doesn't buy you a lot of time when you're decelerating. So that's why this method of having a larger area would help you anywhere really that has an atmosphere. Mars is just one of the many examples.
Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about the inflatable itself. So the inflatable is made up of two major systems. We have the inflatable structure, and then we have a thermal protection system that goes over the article to protect it from the high heat rates that we're experiencing. We have a model. This is a model of our, we launched in 2009, we launched IRVE 2. And IRVE 2 was the first time we successfully demonstrated the inflatable technology. We launched out of Wallops Island on a sounding rocket. We separated from the vehicle. We were exo-atmospheric. We separated from the rest of the shroud. We inflated, and then we returned back through the atmosphere successfully. So the concept is we have the rings. We have about 7 rings on the article itself with the thermal protection system over it. And all of our electronics are currently sewed inside of the payload, the center body itself. But when we go for IRVE 2, it was a 3-meter article. The inflatable was 3 meters, which is about approximately 10 feet in diameter. And then now the concept is that we're moving towards an 8 to 10 meter article, which is giving us more payload to take back. Give you an idea of the size of the inflatable itself. It's about 32 feet in diameter. The concept of how much payload we could bring back, the center body here was only 22 inches fitting inside of the shroud of the sounding rocket. Well, now anymore, this is the diameter of the center body itself, which will allow us to bring about 2,500 pounds of cargo mass to the surface. Do that. Model of the 8.5 meters. And here, this is a demonstration, and the video walks you through this as well. Here's the pressurized cargo module launching on its course 2. And here, as you see, this is the pressurized parking lot.
And I just want to point out, so you can see how tight the fairing was around that cargo, but yet how big this we're able to deploy this.
Right. This is totally stone packed. This is not interstate area here. We get up to space station. We dock on the space station. They offload any cargo that they wanted in the pressurized cargo module. They take that off. And then the astronauts then will refill this module and things they want to bring back. After that, we're now separated. We're still in a passive state with stowed. And we separate from the space station through the maneuvers. We also then separate from the launch, the spacecraft itself. We're doing here. Now you see the pressurized cargo module. This is parked and we're stowed in stowed configuration. Then once we get to our final entry conditions, then we separate and we inflate. We carry a nitrogen tank on board to do the inflation. And then as we inflate, then we re-enter the atmosphere. And the concept is a ballistic entry initially, but then ultimately we are looking at studying ways to control the entry as well. On IRVE 3, which we're launching in April of next year, I don't know if I said that or not yet, we actually have a center of gravity offset system that we install on the vehicle, which will move the center of gravity of the hardware inside the center body, so we can see the effects of the controllability. So ultimately, we want to be able to control it when we land, but initially, we'll see the ballistic entry.
So a little bit about how. So we have this need to land more mass or at higher elevations. We have this concept for here's a solution. So IRVE 2 and IRVE 3, each step is a test to learn more, making sure that this is a viable concept. We're also doing a lot of materials development testing on existing and potentially new materials for the inflatable structure and the thermal protection system itself. So I think Mary Beth mentioned this is the structure part. We have to protect it to keep its rigidity. So you have a very high heat layer. This you saw in the video actually goes from pink to white during that heating process. And then there's some insulation barriers that are under here and a gas barrier. So it's all about, protecting so that this structure doesn't see as high temperature as the outside is. So in order to do that, we have a lot of NASA centers working with us, a lot of commercial entities with us. This concept right here on the video that you showed is kind of one of the eventual steps we have to take before it can be used on a real mission. This would actually demonstrate in an environment similar to, say, Mars. So it would get us at the right heating, the right size of manufacturing this concept, and allow us to do a flight test where we would collect a lot of data. They collect a lot of data on the IRVE 3 and IRVE 2 tests, the temperatures, the pressures, what the shape of the structure looks like, so that we can better understand how it's performing in these environments.
Do you guys have any